Quality Tonali, Intlanextia Intonatio. Buen día a todas y todos. Que tu sol sea brillante. Good day to all. May your sun be brilliant. From wherever you are viewing this program, let us gratefully acknowledge the native peoples on whose ancestral homelands we are currently located, as well as the diverse and vibrant native communities who make wherever you are their home. Thank you for joining us for The Other Slavery, Histories of Indian Bondage from New Spain to the Southwestern United States. This symposium is co-sponsored by the Smithsonian Latino Center, the National Museum of the American Indian, and the National Museum of African American History and Culture, and is associated with the Smithsonian's new initiative, Our Shared Future, Reckoning with Our Racial Past. My name is Eduardo Diaz. I am the director of the Smithsonian Latino Center and interim director of the National Museum of the American Latino. The first half of our symposium featured opening remarks by the Smithsonian Secretary Lonnie Bunch and presentations that focused on the global and national context of Indian bondage, slavery in the Spanish Empire, including the Philippines and the Southwest borderlands, and the living cultures of today's Geniseno community, followed by observations from Kevin Gover, Smithsonian Undersecretary for Museums and Culture. I want to thank my Smithsonian colleagues, the participating scholars, moderators, and members of the Abiquiú community, as well as our scholarly advisory group. As a prelude to my remarks, you saw the lyrics of Naborí, a song by the legendary Puerto Rican composer Catalino Tite Correa Alonso. I am a big salsa music fan, so this song is well known to me. It is from the album With a Little Help from My Friends, a 1973 recording featuring the voice of yet another Puerto Rican legend, Cheo Feliciano. Please check it out on your favorite music streaming service. You'll really enjoy it. I have danced many hours to Naborí and other tunes by Tite Correa Alonso, but it wasn't until I read Andrés Reséndez's seminal book, The Other Slavery, The Uncovered Story of Indian Enslavement in America, that I stopped dancing to listen closely to the lyrics. While reading the book, I came upon references to La Naboría, yet another legal subterfuge employed by Spanish colonists to keep native peoples in servitude. A Naborí, therefore, is the enslaved individual. And as a quick aside, I hope that you have had a chance to read Professor Reséndez's excellent introductory essay to our symposium. Tite Correa Alonso is Afro-Puerto Rican, as is Cheo Feliciano. So understandably, our Naborí in the song is not an enslaved native woman, rather she is an enslaved African working on a sugar plantation, of which there were many in Puerto Rico during the colonial period. Spanish plantation owners took La Naboría, used first to enslave native peoples, and transposed it upon the later arriving African slaves in order to ensure their labor in the cultivation of sugarcane and the manufacture of its related products. Slavery on the island of Puerto Rico was abolished in 1873. As you were able to make out, the song is a lament. Our Naborí, our cherished negra African woman, is bound to the plantation's trapiche, the wooden rollers used to grind sugarcane, la molienda. She works de sol a sol, from sun up to sundown, unable to find peace and the ways of love. She can't even enjoy la rumba, a traditional celebration of music and dance of Africans in Spain's colonial Caribbean. Correa Alonso composed over 2,000 songs, many of them fixtures in the salsa repertoire. Importantly, he was also known for conscientiously lifting up and celebrating Puerto Rican life and traditions, while also offering social commentary about the hardships confronted by his community, like slavery and abusive labor practices. I invoke Naborí as a way to introduce the theme of this section of the symposium, Legacies of Indian Slavery in the United States, because the song's subject matter evidences legacy. In this particular case, an example of popular culture, namely salsa music with a conscience. We see other artistic depictions of native enslavement in these famous Mexican Casta paintings, reflecting what we would recognize today as racial profiling. In an attempt to get a grip on the demographic reality that their invasion and concubinage, much of it forced, engendered, the Spaniards devised a caste system to racially categorize a rapidly growing and increasingly diverse Mexican population. In this image, you see the original 16 racial categories. If alive then, I would probably have fit best into the first upper left-hand caste, the mestizo. DNA analysis indicates that I am 50% Mexican indigenous, probably Chichimeca, and 25% Spanish. In the early days of the Mexican colony, there were more enslaved Africans than there were Europeans, to which you then add Indio Chinos, or Chinese Indians, who began arriving in Mexico from Spain's Asian colonies, principally from the Philippines, which already had a diverse indigenous population of its own, one that produced enslaved labor for the Spanish and the Portuguese. Those of you who heard Professor Tatiana Cejas' presentation got a good sense of the history and impact of this trans-Pacific commerce of human cargo. And of course, there were huge numbers of diverse native peoples who already inhabited Mexico for thousands of years before European contact. In order to manage this dynamic miscegenation, the Spanish imposed the Sistema de Castas to ensure the kind of social, economic, and political order that benefited their colonial interests. Not surprisingly, lighter-skinned progeny was elevated to the upper echelons, while darker-skinned individuals were relegated to the bottom of the social and economic order. Fundamentally, and quite by design, the caste system became a useful tool for policing red, brown, black, and yellow bodies, today's euphemistic people of color. Earlier this year, I visited with the Spanish ambassador to the US. He wanted to learn more about the development of the new Latino Museum. Not surprisingly, he extolled the positive contributions of Spaniards that they had made in the Americas over the centuries. He mentioned las nuevas leyes, the new laws, which were promulgated by the Spanish Crown in 1542, ostensibly to ensure the good treatment and preservation of the Indians, unquote. I reminded the ambassador that while the new laws were being authorized in Spain, nearly 10,000 kilometers and an ocean away in Mexico City, another de facto law was in place. Obedezco, pero no cumplo. I obey, but do not comply. I can't make this stuff up. Spanish colonists had grown accustomed to relying on Indian labor to sustain their business enterprises and way of life. The long arm of Spanish law did not extend far enough to curtail their enslavement practices. The ambassador didn't appear very pleased with my perspective. We also see interest in Indian slavery in more contemporary artwork, like that of Mexican artist Misraim Cárdenas, where he memorializes Indian slave labor as seen in this grabado de Buril or Intaglio, Represión Indígena, or Indigenous Repression. This is a print from 2010. The artistic representation of the practice and legacy of Indian slavery is important and merits further exploration. The second half of the program focuses on the historical intricacies of this mestizaje or miscegenation, how their legacies play out in real time today, including among direct descendants. The session titled Indo-Hispanos, Indigenous and Hispanic Intersections helps bridge sections of the symposium by exploring the northern hinterlands of New Spain, now the Southwest United States, through an Indo-Hispano lens. The session titled Kinship and Genocide in California focuses on California's colonial history, examining kinship systems, the role of the missions, and the catastrophic loss experienced during U.S. territorial period, as well as the survival of indigenous cultures and communities today. The session titled Legacies of Indian Bondage explores the legacies of Indian slavery today, from weakened cultural grounding to forced removal. Topics include intergenerational trauma and public health challenges, and also touches on how museums can further these conversations employing decolonizing approaches. Our colleague Mary Elliott will provide closing reflections at the end of the symposium. This symposium has been a labor of love and exactly the kind of program the Smithsonian must do. Secretary Bunch inspires us to lead with sound research and engaged with unvarnished truths. It is a reasoned and sound path toward reckoning with the past and moving forward with our lives and work ahead. Before I close, I want to thank some people whose commitment and hard work have made this possible. First, Secretary Bunch and Undersecretary Gover, Kevin Young, Director of African American History and Culture, and Michelle Mononicki, Interim Director of American Indian. And to my American Indian colleagues, Maria Maribel Bunch, Michelle Delaney, Elizabeth Kennedy Gish, Margaret Chen, Sean Turman, Tanya Thrasher, Bethany Bentley, Wendy Herlock Baker, and Marielba Alvarez. Thank you so much. Smithsonian Latino Center colleagues, Adriana Aldaba, the glue that held everything together, David Coronado, and Paola Ramirez. To our scholarly advisory group, Gabby Tayak, Patricia Trujillo, Mary Elliott, Phil Deloria, Scott Manning Stevens, and Esteban Rael Galvez. And special thanks to Dr. Patricia Marroquin Norby, formerly of American Indian and now Associate Curator of Native American Art at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, for her early collaboration and guidance. Tlaso Kamati Senka, Tlaso Kamati. De nuevo, gracias. Thank you again for attending our symposium. Take good care.